ahead and stand up with me, please, and let's say the breakthrough prayer together. And it goes like this if you don't know it. Father, unleash the power of the Holy Spirit to bring spiritual breakthrough in my life, in our church family, and in our community. Fill us with humility, unity, and passion. And may your kingdom come and your will be done. And may the name of Jesus be held in high honor in all that we say and do. Amen.
My cross.
may be seated. Let us pray. Jesus, we thank you that no matter what is happening in our life, that you come and meet us where we are at. That there's no place that we can run that your love does not touch, your love does not come near. And so, Jesus, we thank you for that. We ask that you would be able to speak to us through these words that I've prepared and allow your spirit to come into us and begin to do a new work inside of us. In your name we pray. Amen. So we've been in this series called Messes and Miracles. This is the third week out of four. We have one more week, but tonight I really want us to focus in on our limitations and the different things God is able to do. And I did it again this week. Yeah, you want to turn that off? And Emily, can you hand me my Bible? I went up too quick and I did not grab it on my way up. Righty, tighty, lefty, loosey. Fantastic. The baptismal was yelling at us if you couldn't tell. And so when we put our limitation into God's hands, we begin to see his power. And his power becomes limitless to us. And tonight we're going to continue on in the story of Moses. This is a story that has been told time and time and time and time and time again. And I want you to encourage you to look at it anew and afresh. These are stories you may have heard hundreds of times or a few times or at least probably once in your life. And so these are stories that we can put ourselves into a lot of times because God is moving in and through us and allowing these stories to connect with us. Last week we talked a lot about messes in our life and some of the messes that we have created and some of the messes that we participate in others creating for us. And we have to be able to maneuver in and through that. And the biggest miracle that we can experience is Jesus. And that miracle that Jesus comes and gives us that new life, that freedom from the past that we have. And most of us experience big messes in life. Has anybody experienced a big mess in life? And you're just like, how do I get from point A to point B? And it's a struggle and it's painful sometimes. And it hurts so often. Well, Moses experienced big messes. In fact, he created some of them. We learned a lot about that the last week. But before that, God had moved in mighty ways in the first week. And we got to see how God moved in and through. So I encourage you to go ahead and get a Bible if you don't have one. Exodus chapter 3 is where we're going to be in, but I want to give you just a touch of background, a quick recap of kind of where we're at in God's story. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, you guys have all heard those names before, were the forefathers. And the forefathers were able to kind of live pretty awesome lives, sometimes messed up and messy as well, but pretty much tried their best to follow God. And they ended up in Egypt, and then we get to this story where the Egyptians are oppressing the Hebrew people, the Israelites. And we see that Moses is born into a time period that was really, really difficult. He was a Hebrew, but grew up in Pharaoh's house. And we got the story of his birth, which we learned about the first week, where Pharaoh's daughter had seen this basket floating down the river because he ordered a decree. The Pharaoh said, I want all of the boys killed. Every Hebrew boy killed. We would call that genocide today. It's a really terrible thing to like wipe out an entire population of people. And because they were males, that's how they would reproduce and continue to grow and become a big nation within inside of Egypt. And so they see this basket floating and the daughter calls out to one of her servants to go get this basket that's floating down and has a baby in it. And that baby is a Hebrew and she ends up giving it back to the mom to nurse. And then when the baby came of age where she no longer had to nurse, the mother, the Hebrew, gave it back to Pharaoh's daughter. And Moses grew up inside Pharaoh's household, a life of ease and luxury. I mean, you were like considered a son of the king, of one of the most powerful and influential nations at that time. He probably had it pretty easy, but he probably looked a lot different than the people around him. He may even got made fun of. This Bible doesn't tell us. I'm assuming somebody's probably like, dude, you're a Hebrew. You're not even an Egyptian. Anybody ever felt that way? Like you just don't fit in with everyone around you? He began to notice he was different and he began to see the oppression of his people. And so he ends up killing an Egyptian. He took righteous anger and abused it and ended up killing an Egyptian, which is like one of the worst things you can do. Would you guys agree? Like actually physically killing somebody is a pretty bad thing to do, right? I hope I see all of your heads going up and down. Yeah, okay. Bad thing to do. And yet he does it. And then he goes and he hides, which is probably what most of us would do. You don't want to be caught. You don't want to be found out. So he goes and hides. And he lives as a shepherd for about 40 years. And last week we talked about the burning bush. And that's where Moses began to see God's true plan and true potential for him. And I think he probably at the beginning was like pretty on fire in the sense of like not because the bush was burning and he caught fire. But that he was like, dude, I can do this. Then I think things began to set in. And so that's what we're going to pick up. Exodus chapter 3, starting at verse 11. Exodus 3:11, here it goes. It says, if you have this Bible, it's on page 69. If you have the other Bible that's over there, what page is that on? Somebody shout it out. 36. Okay, verse 11. But Moses protested to God. I'm going to pause right there. We didn't get very far, just a few words. You're going to see that multiple times. Moses becomes kind of a punk right now. And he begins to tell God, I don't want to do it. So this is what we're going to see kind of a few different times. But Moses protested God, who am I to appear before Pharaoh? Who am I to lead the people of Israel out of Egypt? God answered him, I will be with you. And this will be a sign that I am the one who has sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God at this very mountain. But Moses protested. There it is again. Moses protested. But if I go to the people of Israel and tell them the God of your ancestors has sent me, they will ask, what is his name? Then what should I tell them? God replied to Moses, I am who I am. Say this to the people of Israel. I am has sent me to you. God said to Moses, say this to the people of Israel, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my eternal name, my name for all, to remember for all generations. Now go and call all the elders of Israel. Tell them the Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, has appeared to me, and he told me, I have been watching closely, and I have seen how the Egyptians have treated you. I promised to rescue you from the oppression in Egypt. I will lead you into the land flowing with milk and honey, a land of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites now live. The elders of Israel will accept your message, and then you and the elders must go to the king of Egypt and tell him, the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, has met with us. So please take a 3-day journey into the wilderness to offer sacrifices to the Lord our God. But I know that the king of Egypt will not let you go unless a mighty hand forces him. And so we get to this point in the story that Moses begins to kind of complain a little bit, right? And we're going to see a little bit more of that in just a few seconds. But Moses has been called to do something great. And it seems like Moses has already given up on it. Seems like Moses is like, man, I don't think I can do that. I don't think I have the ability to do what God is asking me to do. Have any of you ever been there? Like, you feel like you know what to do, but man, do I have the strength? Do I have the energy? Do I have the know-how to accomplish what needs to be done? And it seemed pretty easy. Like, God was going to be with him. He, like, provided his name, which was like this kind of almost like magical key so that they would know exactly who he is. That he was Yahweh, that he was I am. And yet Moses doubts that God can really help him in and through this situation. We're going to go ahead and jump to the next chapter, chapter 4. We're going to go through 1 through 13. And this is the signs of the Lord's power. But Moses protested again. Remember, I said you're going to see that a bit. What if they won't believe me or listen to me? What if they say the Lord has never appeared to you? Then the Lord asked him, what is in your hand? A shepherd's staff, Moses replied. Throw it on the ground. The Lord told him. So Moses threw it down and it turned into a snake. And Moses jumped back. Who would have jumped back? I hate snakes. Hate snakes. I'd have jumped way back. Then the Lord told him, reach out and grab its tail. So Moses reached out and grabbed it and turned back into a shepherd's staff into his hand. Okay, this is what I don't understand. He's afraid to go to Egypt, but he's willing to pick up a snake. Just saying, I'd probably rather go to Egypt than pick up a snake. Anybody ever picked up a snake by its tail? I did it one time. Those things like to bite you when you pick it up by their tail? Just saying. But God does a miracle right there, a miraculous sign, turns it back in because Moses is obedient. And to perform this sign, the Lord told him, then they will believe the Lord, the God of their ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has really appeared to you. Then the Lord said to Moses, now put your hand inside your cloak. Moses put his hand inside of his cloak and took it out again. And it was white as snow with a severe skin disease. A lot of people think that was probably leprosy. Kind of crazy. Now put it back into your cloak, the Lord said. So Moses put his hand back in, and when he took it back out again, it was as healthy as the rest of his body. The Lord said to Moses, if they do not believe you and are not convinced by the first miraculous sign, then they will be convinced by the second. And if they don't believe you or listen to you after these two signs, take some water from the Nile River and pour it out on the dry ground. When you do, the water from the Nile will turn to blood on the ground. But Moses pleaded with the Lord, oh Lord, I'm not very good with words. I have never been, and I am not now. Even though you have spoken, I get tongue-tied and my words get tangled. Then Moses said to the Lord, who makes a person's mouth? Who decides whether a person could speak or don't speak? Hear or do not hear. See or do not see. It is I, the Lord. Now go. I will be with you as you speak, and I will instruct you in what to say. But Moses pleaded again, Lord, please send anyone else. God just spoke audibly to Moses through the burning bush and continued on into this story here. Like, whoa, God actually spoke physical words for him exactly what he's supposed to do. Gave him a game plan. And I would say Moses began to whine at this point. He's like pulling out every trick he can to try to not go. He pleads with God, send anyone else. Have any of us done that? Instead of doing what God is wanting us to do, like make somebody else do it. You know that other person over there? They would be a great candidate for that. We all have had incredible opportunities, and yet fear and insecurity sometimes has robbed us. Those opportunities sometimes slip through the cracks. Because often we do not put our limitation into God's hand, which allows us to see his power, which is limitless. So when I was in college, I had just graduated, going for youth ministry, super excited, and I didn't get a job right away. I got a couple of interviews, and I got turned down because I had no experience, which is pretty common in youth ministry. You have to have experience, but nobody's willing to give you the experience that you need. And so I ended up just finding a job. I ended up working at Noodles & Company, which is a pretty good place to eat, not a great place to work. And I started going through to kind of become a manager. I was a shift manager at the time, but like an actual true, like, general manager of a store. And I started this process, and I got a phone call kind of out of the blue, and it was the church I was a part of. And the pastor was only going to be there for a certain amount of time, and then he was transitioning to a new church. And he kind of let me know that in advance, but they wanted to start hiring for a youth pastor. So when the new pastor came, it was a Methodist church, they would have somebody there. And I got scared. I had a lot of insecurity about it because it was the church that I grew up in, a church that had a lot of baggage and a lot of issues. And I knew all of it. I knew all the secrets. I knew all the dirt. I knew the people. But honestly, I think if I was being real with you, I was afraid of going back to the same community because in college I had changed so much from when I was in high school that I didn't want to have to be around the same people that I was in high school with. And so I had this fear kind of come into my life, this insecurity. And I ended up telling the pastor, I just don't feel like it's a good time. Like, I don't feel like it's God's timing at this time. And I think it was actually a lie. The more I look back on it, I think it was that I wasn't ready. And so for the next 9.5 months, I worked a dead-end job. I never got promoted like they told me. I did all of the training like they told me to do. I was very obedient in the way I felt like I was supposed to. I felt like I was fulfilling my vow. I told the manager I wanted to be, or it was the regional manager, that I wanted to be a manager. Went through all of their coursework. I mean, like, probably 100 hours of work that I didn't get paid for that was, like, studying, taking tests, going to other restaurants, and it was kind of part of the process. And ended up not really doing what I thought I was supposed to do. I got all of the right marks. I did all of the right things that I was supposed to. And so it just kind of like had me feeling like I was in a dead-end job. And I think part of that struggle that I had was that I missed out on something big. A lot of us have missed out on something big, even with COVID. You might feel like a sense of like, man, I've missed out on this, or I've missed out on that. Or maybe it's not even COVID-related. Maybe it was a relationship that you ended poorly, whether that's a significant other or just a friendship that you totally just ruined. Maybe it was a job. You thought you were a shoo-in for this job, and then you didn't get it. Maybe it was a car or a vehicle. I know when I was in high school, I loved my car. And like there was an opportunity to buy an even better one, and it kind of passed me up, and I kind of regretted it later on. And so we have different things in our life, and it will continue as you get older, that you're going to see things kind of pass you by. Sometimes it was something God told you to do. Sometimes it wasn't. But you always have this thing that plays in your brain, the big what if. What if I would have taken that job down near Cincinnati? What if I would have done this? What if I would have done that? What if I didn't apply to this job like 8.5 years ago or 8 years and a couple of months ago? What if? What if you didn't do this? What if you didn't go to the school God wants you to go into? And so I want us to take just a quick pause in the midst of all of that, knowing that our limitation sometimes put a pause on what God can do. We focus so much on what we can do, the skills we have, the things we can do, that a lot of times we push God out of the picture. And instead of inviting God in, like, God, where do you want me to go to school? And you may get an answer and you may not. God, what do you want me to do for my future? And I know for myself, I wrestled with that for years and years. And honestly, I still wrestle with it today. Like, God, do you want me in youth ministry still? Do you want me to go do something else? I don't know. And so I always keep that on the table for God. What are you wanting me to do? And a lot of times we focus on our limitations, our strengths, or actually normally our weaknesses, instead of what God can do in and through us. This is what Moses did. He focused in on his complaints. They won't know who you are. Why would they know who you are? I'm the guy who killed the stinking Egyptian back in Egypt. I was trying to do your work, God, is probably what he honestly thought. And yet he fled into the desert for 40 years to hide. But he was focused on his limitations. He probably had a true stuttering problem, but he whined about it because he let his weakness get in the way. So I want to encourage you in a couple of different ways tonight. Embrace your weakness. Weakness in our culture is seen as a bad thing. Would you guys agree? Like if you have a weakness, like I know when I even fill out, like we do like evaluations and it like write out your weaknesses, I actually struggle. And I'm sure like you could probably tell me in like 2 seconds my weaknesses, but like I put blinders up to my weaknesses. Does anybody else do that? Like you might not be good at this, so you just put like a blinder up so you don't focus on it. And that's very indicative of our culture. But God is saying to us tonight to embrace our weakness so God has a chance to show off his strength. And you might just think, well, Mark, you're just making that up. Actually, I'm not. This is actually coming from the Apostle Paul. At the beginning is a quote from Jesus. My grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness. I'm going to say that again. My grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness. And then Paul writes this. So now I am glad to boast about my weakness. Paul's talking about boasting. You guys know what boasting is? Puffing up your chest like, I'm big and bad about my weakness. That's counterintuitive to what we believe and think today, right? We don't ever lead, you go into an interview, you don't ever lead with, well, here are my 6 weaknesses. You know what I mean? You're not going to like spell out like I never show up on time. I don't actually follow through with any commitments I say. I don't do this. I don't do that. Like that's not how you, let me tell you, that's not how you go into an interview. But Paul is writing that he says that we can boast in our weakness so that the power of Christ can come through. That is why I take pleasure in my weakness, in the insults, the hardships, the persecutions and trouble that I will suffer for Christ. That's stuff we probably don't actually want to read. We don't actually want to believe that. I'm just being honest, because that's hard. That's not easy. When people insult us, hardships, persecution, trouble, it reminds me of the Beatitudes. You know, it's like kind of the end of the Beatitudes, Matthew chapter 5, 12. It talks about like when people insult you, would persecute you, would say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Like, that's not fun stuff we want to kind of look at, but it's the truth. Sometimes the truth is really hard because when we become weak, God's power can shine through. We begin to see how powerful God really, truly is. The second thing I think we need to realize is that leadership is not actually leadership. It's followership. To lead, you have to follow. Leadership is a word that gets thrown out a lot right now. TED Talks is all about leadership. Anybody ever seen a TED Talk? TED Talk is all about leadership, which is great. But to lead, you must be following somebody else. And so Jesus, I think, kind of sets this up. He sets up this concept called discipleship, that we become disciple, that we become Jesus' apprentice. Moses kind of does this, except Moses sees God as his apprentice. And it took Moses a long time to realize this, but as you begin to read, he begins to actually follow what God is telling him to do. And he actually kind of does a decent job here and there. Sometimes he fails big time. If you're reading through the Bible, you've seen that in a year, that like in especially some of Numbers and stuff, there's some rough patches. But leadership, you have to follow. And as followers of Jesus, the best example I can ever think of is Jesus. That our relationship with God must be intact. If we're truly going to see God move through our weaknesses, we must meditate on his word day and night. And that doesn't mean you literally have to read scripture 24/7, but you begin to read it. You begin to internalize it. You begin to allow God to use it in and through your life. You begin to pray without ceasing, which is kind of that same concept, that our prayer life becomes just kind of a natural part of our life. That sometimes there is no amen ever. You know how like we pray and we say amen and it's like back to normal, right? Pray without ceasing is like a prayer without an amen. You just keep praying throughout the day. When somebody offends you or insults you or persecutes you, you see it as an opportunity to share Jesus with them. It's hard. If you've ever been in that situation, I have a number of times. It is so incredibly difficult. But God is glorified in and through it. The other thing you need to do is surround yourself with good friends that are healthy and leaders like our life group leaders and other people in the church who will point you to Jesus. When you begin screwing up in life, you have somebody you know you can come and talk to. That when that mess gets so big and it begins to snowball into other things, that you're able to take that pause in your life that you need and be like, hey, I need help. And have somebody you can trust and rely on to be there for you. And I also think we need times that are just quiet. That we take our phone. I don't know if you guys know this. If you have an iPhone, if you hold down these two buttons, there's this little thing that says slide to power off. That right there can be one of the most freeing things in your entire life. To be able to truly turn off your devices. And I'm terrible at it. I'm going to be the first to admit it's something I struggle with. But it's one of those things that when we get able to find quiet and able to find the peace, God can speak to us. Moses was out walking the wilderness near Mount Sinai, and he begins to see a bush on fire. If he was playing with his phone, I know mine's off right now, but if he was playing on his phone, they didn't have phones back then, but if he was, and he's playing with his phone, he would have never seen that bush on fire. He would have never had the opportunity he had because he would have let it slip by because he did not focus on the things that mattered most. But when he began to see the different things going on around him, he was able to follow God and to become the leader he was supposed to be. The last thing I want to encourage you with is to depend on the Holy Spirit. I think one of my favorite things about God is that he is triune. And I'm going to throw a couple of big words out there, but it's all kind of the same thing, that he is three persons in one. He is the Trinity. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Each person is super important, and yet they're all one. Okay, I know, mind blown, really hard to grasp, big theological concept, but it's one of those baseline things in Christianity that is so important because each person of the Trinity assists us and helps us in lots of different ways. I want to focus in briefly on the Holy Spirit tonight. Holy Spirit is super important in the life of a follower of Jesus. And here are two different scriptures to kind of help point some of that out and to kind of help kind of guide and direct us. So the first one is John 16:7. But in fact, it is best for you that I go away, because if I don't, the advocate won't come. If I don't go away, if I go away, then I will send him. Advocate is the Holy Spirit. Advocate is the Holy Spirit. So Jesus is saying, if I do not go, if I do not go to the cross, die, resurrect, and ascend into heaven, you won't have the Holy Spirit. Jesus was one finite person and fully God at one time in history. At that point, he couldn't be in Israel and in North America or in South America or in Asia at that same time. Jesus had some limitations. Jesus couldn't be everywhere with all of the followers of God at once. John 14:12-14. This is just a couple of chapters before. Jesus says, I tell you the truth, anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done, and even greater works, because I am going to the Father. You can ask for anything in my name, and I will do it, so that the Son will bring glory to the Father. Yes, ask me anything in my name, and I will do it. This is one of those crazy things, that when Jesus ascends to go live with God forever in heaven at the right hand of God, you guys remember that if you said the creeds with us before, ascended into heaven, sit at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. At that point in time, Jesus has the same limitless power as God does. And he says, when we ask for anything in his name, we have the opportunity to receive it. Now, does that mean if you ask for a PlayStation 5, you're going to get it? Probably not. But I'm not going to say God wouldn't do something crazy like that. I mean, Jesus took a couple of loaves of bread and a couple of fish and fed 5,000. Actually, probably more like 1,500, because it says 500 men, and a lot of times they probably had children and possibly their spouse was there. So lots and lots of people with very little. But the kind of the point of what I'm trying to say is that a lot of times we focus on our own strengths. We focus on what matters kind of most to us, our abilities, our passions, our knowledge, our strength. We trust in our own abilities and neglect God. We don't allow God to come near to us and to allow the Holy Spirit to come in and to use us in big and mighty ways. This past December was one of the hardest months of my life. My grandpa passed away. I was not able to see him. He was down in kind of Hoover, Alabama, near Birmingham. And it was just gut-wrenching. I was like, I can't go see my grandpa. He's dying. I got to FaceTime him. I mean, he was literally on his deathbed. He was not responding. It was really kind of difficult to even have a kind of a conversation. And I just got led to just pray over him for about 5 minutes. And I don't honestly know if my grandpa is going to be in heaven. I have no clue. My grandpa kind of lived a life that looked godly on the outside, but there wasn't a whole lot of depths. And if you follow scripture, like, that doesn't get you to heaven being a good person. And so it was kind of gut-wrenching. And then I got asked just a couple days after he passed that I would do the funeral, which I would have said, like, yes immediately, but, like, that was the first funeral I've ever done, was my grandpa. And I can't even say that he was a follower of Jesus, which is really difficult. Like, I surrounded myself with my family for a couple of days right before the funeral, and I was like, tell me every story you know about grandpa and God. And the only thing they said is that he would drop them off and he would to church, and sometimes he would, like, work on, like, building campaigns. So, like, this was a building campaign, this portion of the building at one point. And so, like, he was real big into that kind of stuff, but a deep faith with Jesus was most likely inexistent. Now, I don't know what God and him were talking about on the final moments of his life, but it was one of those things I was like, God, I need help. How am I going to write a sermon on my grandpa's life? And I'm like, I have no idea what I'm going to do. And God ended up reminding me of some different things in the past. I remember when I was kind of younger, he had talked about how he went to the church and his grandma went to the other church and his grandma wouldn't come to that church because guess what? They sung hymns and they were rebellious. They did Gregorian chants at my grandma's church. I'm not going to show you what a Gregorian chant is. If the band would like to do that afterwards, John, you know any? Okay, we'll pass on that. So if you think that the traditional service is traditional, you don't even understand. Gregorian chants are crazy. But that was one of the only stories I know about my grandpa talking about church and his participation in church. But it was hard because I didn't have a whole lot to go off of. And I was like, God, I need your help. And God was able to give me some different stories and some different insights. And really to be able to preach the gospel without talking about my grandpa's life very much, but being able to tell people, like, if you want the salvation of Jesus, this is what you have to do. So I was able to put my limitations into God's hands. It was hard. Like, to go to a funeral is hard. Would you guys agree? Like, I'm not going to lie. I'm a pastor, and I can't stand going to funerals. Like, it makes me super, super sad every single time I go. And yet, to lead one is just kind of a totally different, like, blow-your-mind reality. Because I had to be able to give God everything. Because I was like, God, I don't have much. Here it is. Use me. Allow me to be able to help my family grieve and mourn. And to be able to have some kind of hope in you in the midst of all of this. So putting our limitation in God's hand, we begin to see how powerful God truly is. His power is limitless. So I want to encourage you throughout the rest of this week to read Exodus chapter 4 through 15. We got part of the way through 4 because God's about to show up and do some big, big miracles. Actually, 12 of them. And they're not actually pretty nice. I mean, they're actually really kind of harsh. But the whole thing is that Moses would keep going back to Pharaoh and say, Pharaoh, let us go worship God. Let us go on a three-day journey. And Pharaoh became hard-hearted and said no. So God turned water into blood, sent frogs, lice, wild animals upon the Egyptians. Their livestock became deceased. Everyone got boils in the land. Thunderstorms of hail and fire rained down. Locusts swept the land, and it was dark for 3 days. And finally, the firstborn of all of the sons of Egypt died. After all that, Pharaoh decided to let the people go. And yet he changed his mind again, and you guys know this story. They're at the back of the sea, their backs are to the sea, and here comes Pharaoh's army. Pharaoh wants this million plus slaves back. And God parts the sea, completely separates it, allows dry land for the people to walk on. They get to the other side, and the sea closes back in on Pharaoh and his soldiers, all of the different chariots. And so we kind of see this tension of allowing God to use us in our weakness, that God would allow Moses and Aaron to be able to speak to Pharaoh, even though Moses was a stumbling kind of fool, I guess you would say. He couldn't get the words out of his mouth. So God spoke to Moses in many different ways and allowed Moses to be included in this great rescue plan for all of the Hebrew people. But Moses often fixated on his limitations. But God doesn't take no for an answer. When God calls us to something, he's going to help us through it. Sometimes that means you might lose some of the blessing. Moses lost some of the blessing in the sense that he wasn't the one to perform all of these miracles. He had to have his brother Aaron come by his side. And so for you and for I, we need to see that we need to give God our limitations. Give God our weakness. Put it in God's hands. And I guarantee you God will do something big in and through your life. And it's not so as it's something big that you can claim is yours. But remember what Paul says, it's always pointing it back to Jesus. That Jesus gets the glory and the honor in and through it. So no matter what is going on in your life, no matter how messy it is, turn that mess over to God. Put all of your limitations in his hands and allow him to do something great in and through you. Let's pray. Jesus, we thank you for your love, for your grace. We thank you that you are not done with us, that we might be damaged goods to some people, but Jesus, you died on the cross for us. You show your grace, your love, your forgiveness to even a sinner like me, to even a sinner like everyone in this room and those who will watch us online later. Jesus, your love is big enough and great enough for even me. And I thank you for that, that I can turn all of my limitations, all of my bad attitudes, all of my complaints over to you, and you can do something with those. In your name we pray. Amen.
Father God, we just pray as we go forth into our life group times, God, that you would just be in the midst of that, God, that just like right now, as we are gathered here in worship and have heard the words that Mark has spoken, God, let us just focus in on that, and as we be in community with each other, God, just to be open to what you have for that time. God, we pray for the food. We bless it for our strength and bless the hands that prepared it. And we love you so much. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So as usual, $3, if you don't have it this week, please pay it next week. Or if you pay like $5, pay whatever you owe. I don't know math.